Blackstone Audio presents A Paper Sun by Jason Buchholz. This book is read by Feodor Chin. 1. First I saw him in a teacup. It was the day before the storm hit, the storm we'd been watching on newscast Doppler as it approached from Alaska, devouring the coast like a carnivorous planet made of teeth and ice and smoke. The weather persons pointed to it, their expressions mixes of glee and trepidation, their predictions heavy with superlatives, italics, underlining. The storm had formed in the Arctic over Siberia and had lurched eastward, devastating docks, leveling marinas, sending grapefruit-sized hailstones through windshields. Bering Sea waves had knocked some of the lesser islands in the Aleutian archipelago from their moorings and sent them tumbling southeast through sea foam, piling their igneous ruins on the British Columbian coast, along with uprooted trees, demolished fishing boats, polar bear carcasses. This same fury would soon be upon us, blotting out the sun, stealing whole chunks of the peninsula out from under us, but not yet. That day, the first day back in school after the winter break, it was still clear. An unbroken blue stretch of sky filled my classroom windows. The only indications of the coming maelstrom were the taut horizontal flags over the skyscrapers downtown. My third graders were hard at work, their pencils scratching unevenly across their papers. They were writing about all the things they hadn't done during their vacations. I'd introduced the assignment the previous year, after 9 years of reading the same excruciating paragraphs about Santa preparations and skiing in Tahoe and trips to Disneyland. Today I had received the usual panel of puzzled stares when I'd written the topic on the whiteboard.
"Can you provide an example?" Eliza Lowe asked, looking bemused.
"Did you get eaten by a lion over the break?" I asked her. Eliza was destined for a station in life where she would have people twice as smart as I am working so far under her, she'd never even know their names. And from the look she gave me then, I could tell she was a little impatient for that day to arrive.
"Actually, I did," she said. "We kids heal up fast."
"Well, then you'll have to write about something else," I said. Kevin Hammerschmidt raised his hand.
"I didn't get eaten by a lion, Mr. Long," he said, and flashed me a grin short on teeth.
"You could have written about that then," I said. "But now you have to come up with something else, because that was my idea. 15 minutes, go." This was not the first time I'd augmented the Common Core curriculum. I teach my kids cooking and bicycle repair. In PE, they like to play dodgeball, but every now and then, I make them do Tai Chi. I tell them it will make them better ball dodgers. In my English lessons, I charge them with the guardianship of the language. I have them identify and revise poor writing from the adult world. Despite the school's ban on handing out refined sugars, I distribute Hershey's Kisses to anybody who brings in a newspaper or magazine article with grammatical errors. I teach them words they'll appreciate, like brachiate. They love the monkey bars, after all. To brachiate, I tell my class each year, means to propel oneself by swinging from arm to arm like a monkey. Shortly after this year's lesson, I heard Amanda Martin say, "Nice brachiating," to her friend Savannah Stewart as Savannah dismounted, and I was again reminded why I love my job. I also teach them to be better storytellers. Problems are the main ingredient, I tell them. At the beginning of each term, I tell them to create a character and then give him 5 problems in 1 page. Just before the first recess bell rang, I collected their papers and encouraged them to go outside and play at triple their normal intensity. "When this storm hits," I told them, "it's going to be the end of everything we know and love." This was a game we played. I'd make a dubious proclamation, and their job was to show some skepticism, to investigate, to question adults, especially their teachers. We all glanced out the window, as if the sky might tell us how much time we had left. Several gulls wheeled over the playground, anticipating the spillage of raisins and graham crackers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.